series, hopefully as you know by now, called Limitless God. We've been in this series for the last 5 weeks. And what we've been doing is we've been looking at the different attributes of God, really to try and understand what God is really like, to get our heads around what the Bible says, to give us a different aspects of who he is, who we worship, who can be involved in our lives. And we're looking at each different attribute as to the nature of God. Now today I want to look at God's sovereignty. 1 Chronicles 29 verse 11 says this: "Everything in the heavens and earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as being in control of everything." Sovereignty simply means that God is in control, and therefore he is in control of absolutely everything because he himself is the creator and he created all things. God says in Isaiah 45 verse 12, "I am the one who made the earth and created people to live on it. With my hands I stretched out the heavens. All the millions of stars are at my command." He sustains creation. And when he wants to overrule it, he will do a miracle. It is his prerogative to do that. He is in perfect control of everything. He has created time. God is above and beyond and outside all the contingencies that go on in the created universe. He is transcendent. He is high and lofty. He is majestic and lifted up. And he is working to perfection his plan for the universe, for humanity, for your life. He has everything under the control, all of the time, and in perfect knowledge, he is bringing to completion the plan which he ordained from the beginning of time. That is the God that we worship. And therefore, God is in control of history. God says in Isaiah 46, verses 9 to 10, "I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say, my purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please." The Bible says that everything is moving towards a focus, that there is a plan, there is a purpose, there is a climax that history is moving towards. God is also in control of our lives. Scripture says that God's sovereignty decided when you were going to be born. God even sovereignly decided where you were going to be born. And God has decided already how long you are going to live. Job 14:5 says, "You," that is God, "have decided the length of our lives. You know how many months we will live, and we are not given a minute longer." So the Bible says that God has already decided what he's going to do in our lives, how long we're going to live. He also decides what natural abilities and gifts that you are going to have that you didn't deserve and you don't earn. You were born with certain talents, and God has given them to you in his sovereignty. Now, all of that raises a question. If God is in control of everything, do I even have a choice? Is there really any freedom? Well, yes, there is freedom, but it is limited. There are boundaries to your freedom. There are parameters to which you cannot go beyond. So therefore, in a sense, you do not have total freedom. Because you're a human being, you have freedom of choice. You're not some kind of puppet that God has made. He could have made it like that, but he didn't. But we are not totally free in the way in which the world thinks that we are. It's like, let me give you an example. It's like you were to play a game of chess with God. Let's try and think of it like that. Now, you would have the freedom to make many, many different moves in that game. But since you were playing God, well, there'd be no doubt as to who would eventually win that game, would there? God, because he knows the game a little bit better than you do. Or you were perhaps on an ocean liner and you were going to the Caribbean. While you're on that trip, you could go on the top deck of that ship and you could watch movies and sleep and eat and eat food and play shuffleboard or whatever that is and swim. And you could do all these kinds of different things. Lots of freedom on that boat, but there was nothing that you could do that would alter the ultimate destination of that ocean liner. So the Bible says that God gives you freedom to choose the way you want to live, the way that you want to act, but once you've made those choices, you're no longer free. You're not free to choose the consequences of your actions. God says, if you do certain things, then certain things are going to be the result. In other words, the Bible says you reap what you sow. So, if you do A, then B is going to happen as a result, and it will happen as a result in your life, because God is in control. Now, that's a theological concept. what does that mean for us? What does that mean in our lives on a day-to-day basis? And I want to take this idea that God is in control, and I'll talk about three practical ways this applies to our lives. That's what we're trying to do over this series, over these last 3 weeks, until the end of the series, is, so what? If God is that, what does that mean for me? How does God is in control, how does that impact our plans, our problems, and our prayers? First of all, let's look at my plans. The Bible says that since God is in control, my plans have a limit. There is a limitation to our plans. You've heard that phrase, haven't you? The sky is the limit. But that's nonsense, because the sky isn't the limit. God is. So he decides what are the limitations in your life. So Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. We change our plans all the time because we get more information, don't we? I'm sure you probably changed some ideas and plans even this week, because circumstances change, don't they? We understand a little bit more about the situation. Well, God never changes anything. His purpose is fixed. I mean, would you agree that God often has a better idea, and that he often changes our plans, that at best, our plans are tentative? Proverbs 16 verse 1 says, we may make our plans, but God has the last word. Have you discovered that things do not always go the way you planned them to go? Things haven't gone to plan in your life as you thought they might have done? Or the unexpected happens, and then all of a sudden, your life is in a bit of a spin. And at best, our plans are tentative because we can't see ahead. We don't know the future. We make plans, but really, they are, or they should be, changeable. Because many times, God has a better idea. How many of you did not marry the first person you intended to marry? Or the first career you intended to go into? God has changed your plans. And we need to be tentative in our plans. We need to be flexible in our plans. So when we come to making plans, we can either have a wrong attitude or a right attitude. So the wrong attitude is this. The wrong attitude is presumption. When I say, I don't need God and I can figure it all out, I know exactly what I'm going to do, I'm not going to pray about anything, that is presumptuous. I assume that everything is going to go a certain way it's intended to go. I assume that's how it's going to be. Well, that's presumption. That is the wrong attitude. Presumptuous. James 4:13-15 says that since life is uncertain, we shouldn't presume on it. Now listen, he says, you who say today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business there, make money. Well, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. Now it's okay to make plans as long as you understand that they are tentative. A mature person makes his plans flexible. Some people make plans, and if anything varies their plans, particularly if you're a bit of a control freak, if anything varies your plans, you're going to get an ulcer, aren't you? No, mature faith is changeable in the sense that our plans are changeable and tentative. I make plans, but I realise ultimately that God calls the shots in my life. So what is the right attitude? Well, the right attitude is cooperation. I include God in my plans. How? Well, you pray. Anything without prayer is presumption. Instead of saying, God, I want you to bless what I'm doing, we should say, God, help me to do what you're already blessing. See, people used to write at the end of letters. Do you remember seeing the words DV? You often, sometimes perhaps, those of you who are older will perhaps remember this. You'd write the words DV, which stands for Deo Vilante, which means God willing. That's what it means. People would write that at the end of the letters. Or letters. Do you remember letters? You know, perhaps we should put in our emails. But anyway, it's this idea, the Lord is willing. So, the Lord willing. So, I'm going to come and see you, the Lord willing. You know, I'm going to do this, God willing. But I make plans, realise that ultimately my plans might be changed. You know, it's not a bad attitude, is it? To do this if the Lord is willing. That's the right attitude. Proverbs 16:9 says, we should make plans counting on God to direct us. That is cooperation. See, the more mature you become as a believer, the more flexible you become, the more open to change you are without getting an ulcer. Why? Because you realise how little you know. The older I get, I don't know about you, but the older I get, the more I realise how much I don't know. See, when I was 16, I knew everything. And my dad knew nothing. It's amazing how smart he got by the time I got to 21, I must say. But the older you get, the more you realise our best plans, our best efforts are only tentative. God is. So make plans, yes, but realize they should always be made in a tentative way. God, what do you want me to do? And if it's not what I should be doing, please show me. Pray about your plans. Ask him for wisdom. So since God is in control, my plans have a limit. Now, what about my problems? Secondly, then, my problems. Because God is in control, my problems have a purpose. Now, that's good news. And the reason that is good news is that life is not just a series of random events with no meaning, accidents that just sort of come and go. Life has a meaning. Life has a purpose. It's an awful way to live if you believe that life is meaningless, that we're just floating around and live for today and that's it. What a horrible way to live. Now, if you are a believer, nothing comes into the life of a believer without the Heavenly Father's permission. Everything that happens in your life, even the bad stuff, is Father-filtered. It cannot come into your life without his permission. So because God says that my problems have a purpose, I can relax. Because no matter what happens in my life, God has a purpose behind it. 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7 says, at present, you may be temporarily harassed by all kinds of trials. This is no accident. It's not an accident, the problems that you're facing. It happened to prove your faith, which is infinitely more valuable than gold. So if you are a child of God, nothing can come into your life without the Heavenly Father's permission. Nothing. Because God is in control. He is sovereign. Now, let me unpack that a bit, because some of you are going to struggle with that statement. I am not saying that everything that happens is God's will, because it isn't. There are many things that happen in life that are not God's will. So, sin is not God's will. Someone gets cancer, must be God's will. Well, who says? Someone's in an accident and dies, well, that must be God's will. Who says? We are to pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because God's will is not always done here on earth, is it? We know that. I'm not saying that everything is God's will or that he causes everything, because he doesn't. He doesn't cause everything. He doesn't cause sin. He doesn't even cause all of your problems. He doesn't have to. The reason why he doesn't have to is because, well, you bring enough problems on yourself, don't you? And other people bring enough problems on you too. He doesn't have to cause problems in your life. But what I am saying is this. God allows, he permits problems in our lives. And then he uses them for a greater purpose. God is a pro at turning bad things into good things. He's an expert at taking problems and bringing the greater purpose out of them. So, for example, God could have kept the Apostle Paul out of prison at Philippi, but he let him go to prison. He allowed it. And as a result, the jailer became a Christian. God could have said to the Pharaoh, yes. God could have had Pharaoh say yes when Moses said, let my people go. But instead, Pharaoh said no, so that God could show all of his miracles and the 10 plagues. God could have kept Jesus from going to the cross and not have the crucifixion. But he allowed the crucifixion so he could do a resurrection. God allows problems in our lives. He doesn't have to cause them. Very often we cause them ourselves, in fact. We bring them on ourselves or other people cause them. So do not blame God for all the evil in the world. That's a red herring question that people will ask. And you may even think that yourself. You do not blame God for the evil in this world. He allows it and it brings it into focus that we need his help. Let me give you some examples in the Bible. Here's some characters in the Bible where they understood this, who lived this out. Job. Now, Job was the wealthiest man in the world, and he lost it all overnight. Imagine that. He went bankrupt, and all of his family was killed except his nagging wife. Terrific. Thanks for that, God. And then he got a dreaded disease, and then he was really miserable. Even Satan couldn't get at Job without God's permission. And Satan had to come to God and say, look, can I do this to Job? And God says, well, you can do this, but no further. Now, this is really important to understand. Satan cannot even get out of your life without God's permission. Satan and God are not equal. They do not have equal authority. Satan is a creature. He was created like anything else. There is only one God, and even Satan has to do what God says. And God only allows him here for a short period of time, and then Satan will be destroyed. And the question of evil is a really complicated one, which I'm not answering this morning. But what I'm saying is this, is that God is in control. If you lost everything the way Job did, how would you respond, I wonder? Well, let's look at how Job responded. This is what he says, Job 1:21. The Lord gave me everything I had, and they were his to take away. Wow. They were his to take away. And then he says, blessed be the name of the Lord. Job says, everything I have comes from God anyway. He gave it to me. He has the right to take it all away. Would you say that? See, the end of the story is that God later restored everything the devil had taken away. Twice as much, in fact. And Job was twice as well. Job was twice as wealthy, twice as many kids, because God was in control. Now, if he wants to turn off the tap, he can turn it on elsewhere. If you lose your job, God will give you another one. God can turn it around because God is in control. He says, Job says, blessed be the name of the Lord, he is in control. He is a good God and knows what he's doing. Let me give you another example. What about Joseph? Joseph is a great story, but we forget sometimes that it is more than just Andrew Lloyd Webber's musical. It is actually a story of a real person. Joseph is an example of how do you handle it when people hurt you intentionally. Remember the story? Joseph was his father's favourite son. All of his brothers got very jealous. They decided, therefore, to sell Joseph into slavery. They told their father that he'd been killed by a wild beast, in fact. They sell him into slavery and he's taken to Egypt. Well, you think that's bad enough? No, it gets worse because he's sold as a slave into a man's house. The man's wife then tries to seduce him. He won't give in. He's therefore accused of rape. He's then put in prison and he spends years in prison, dwindling away. And I'm sure he was saying, where is God in all of this? Why do I deserve this? I mean, if I were Joseph, I would be saying, why me, God? Why me? But Joseph was exactly where God wanted him to be. God was in control, and God was working through the circumstances and the situations. He didn't cause it, but he allowed the brothers to sell Joseph into slavery, and later on, you read the rest of the story, later on Joseph rose to a position of prominence in Egypt, and there was a great famine, and because of his wisdom, both Egypt and Israel were saved. And later, he came face to face with the very brothers who tried to hurt him. And Genesis 50, verse 20, is one of the greatest verses in the Bible. Joseph says this to his brothers. He says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. Wow. God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. That's an incredible statement, isn't it? Now, maybe some of you are hurt right now. You've been hurt by your boss at work, or by work colleagues, or brothers, or sisters, or parents, or husband, or wife, or other people, whoever. And they mean it for bad, but God means it for good. There are people who are out to destroy you, or they don't like you, and they are trying to get at you. They mean it for bad, but God is in control, and he means it for good, and he's got a purpose behind every problem that you face. And if that is true, and it is, how should I respond to my problems, knowing that every problem has a purpose behind it, that God hasn't caused it, but he's permitted it for a reason? What is the key to my response? It is this: find God's purpose behind the pain. In other words, look past the pain. Try to find God's purpose behind the pain. Some things in life, we are never, ever going to know the reason why. You know, as human beings, and I think more so in our society today, we want to know the answers to absolutely everything. Why? Why do these things happen? So why do people die at a certain time? Particularly perhaps when they had life ahead of them. I don't know. We all die eventually, we know that. But why this person now? I don't know. But I do know that God has a plan and God is a good God. He is in control. So look past the pain. 2 Corinthians 4:16 to 17, Paul says this. This is the reason we never lose heart. These troubles, which are temporary, are winning for us a permanent, glorious and solid reward out of proportion to our pain. God says, the temporary problems you are going through right now are minor compared to the reward that you're going to be given the other side and how you handle things. Because in the very next verse, Paul says, so we don't look at the troubles we can see right now. Rather, we look forward to what we have not yet seen. For the troubles we see will soon be over, but the joys to come will last forever. Look past the pain. God is in control. So your problems have a purpose. Your plans have a limit. What about our prayers? Thirdly, my prayers, because God is in control, my prayers have an impact. They make a difference. They are worthwhile. It's not a waste of time to pray. Have you ever prayed and you felt that you were just sort of blown off steam? You sometimes think, is anyone really hearing this stuff? Is this a waste of time? You know, just bouncing, my prayers seem like they're just bouncing off the ceiling. And if God hears me, will he ever answer? Particularly if you're praying a prayer time and time again, and then the devil whispers in your ear, what a waste of time. What are you doing that for? Who do you think you're kidding? I mean, prayers are a bunch of mumbo jumbo. It's futile, it's worthless, it's unproductive, it's irrelevant. What are you doing wasting your time praying? You ever find he ever says that to you? But the truth is, prayer works because God is in control. And because God is in control, he can control the uncontrollable. You have a higher authority that you can appeal to. He can do things that you never thought possible, and therefore prayer works. God has the ability to answer your prayers. But if God is not sovereign, if we say God is not in control, well then prayer is a waste of time, isn't it? Who wants to pray to somebody who is not all-powerful and who can't answer? Can you imagine a prayer to God? Praying to God, come to God in prayer and say, God, I really need this change. Or, Lord, I'm struggling with this. I really need your help in this area. Please, Lord, please answer my prayer. And God says, well, I'd like to help, but I can't, unfortunately. I don't have the power to do it. It's not in my job description. When I gave out my job description to me and all the things that I could do, unfortunately, I forgot to put that in. So sorry. I'm a little bit embarrassed by it. It frustrates me as much as it does you, but I just can't do anything about it. See, God never says that's too hard. God is sovereign. Well, then we can pray, and it does make an impact. That is the basis of every miracle. God is in charge of everything, and therefore he can change things. He can overrule nature. He can heal anybody. He can make time last longer, or he can make it rain when it doesn't rain, or he can split the Red Sea. He can turn water into wine. He can do anything he wants to. Ephesians 3:20 says, God is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or even dream of, infinitely beyond our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, or hopes. So here's the thing. You can pray the greatest prayer request that you can ever imagine, and God says, I can top that. See, nothing is too hard, too difficult, because he is sovereign. He is in control. God says, think of the greatest prayer request, the wildest dream you can think of, and I can go beyond that. Because his resources are unlimited and are available. The point is this, prayer can do whatever God can do. So why don't we take more advantage of it? See, if we believe that prayer isn't mumbo-jumbo, why don't we pray more? Because prayer is tapping into the resources of the entire universe. God's power. Because over 20 times in the New Testament, the Bible says, ask, seek, knock. God says, I want you to ask. I am in charge. I am in control. Ask, and I'll show you great and mighty things that you don't know. Let me blow your mind. Prayer does have an impact. Now, it's encouraging to me that things that are beyond my control, things that I think are out of control in my life, things that concern me and worry me, I know that I can take them to God because he's in control. So that's good news, isn't it? Well, I think it's good news anyway. See, some of you might say, oh man, my kids are out of control. Well, they're not out of God's control. My health is out of control. I can't do anything about it, but it's not out of God's control. My finances are falling apart. It feels hopeless. Well, they're not out of God's control. there is nothing beyond God's control. That means that in my present situation, I don't have any control over, I cannot control that situation, then I can pray about it. Because God can control it. And that is the power of prayer. Now, some of you are thinking, yeah, fine, fair enough. Okay, we get that. But since God is in control and he can do anything and he's told me to pray, then why don't I get everything that I ask for? Why hasn't he answered that prayer that I've been praying? Why hasn't he done that sort of thing that I want? Well, there's many reasons for that. It's a good question. But there's many reasons. Let me give you two reasons to think of. Number one, God is not a genie. Some of us think of God like that when we pray. You know, we think, well, if we pray hard enough, you know, sort of rub the lamp of prayer, as it were, poof, he comes up, whatever can I do for you? And then he gives us an answer to our prayer straight away. Some of us have this sort of idea that God is this sort of genie. Whatever you ask for happens. No. Can you imagine what a mess our world would be in if God answered every single prayer of every single person exactly the way the person desires? Prayer would be like a weapon, wouldn't it? It'd be like the Midas touch, wouldn't it? It would ruin everybody. Or you'd become full of pride, wouldn't you? You'd become a bit of show-off. You'd be some sort of show-offy, magician-y type person. If God answered every prayer, it would ruin us because we don't know how to handle that kind of power. And the other thing is that oftentimes there are competing prayers, aren't they? Christians pray in conflict. So, for example, two Christians are at the FA Cup and pray for the opposite team, so that team will win. Well, obviously, God can't answer both of those prayers, can he? One person prays for it to rain, the other person prays for it to be sunny. There's a conflict. And also, we don't have enough total knowledge, so we often pray by mistake. We don't pray the right thing. We pray with this sort of limited view. And I don't know about you, but I am so pleased that some of the prayers that I've prayed, God hasn't answered because I've been a right old mess now. That's not what was good for me, best for me. The bottom line why God doesn't answer all requests is that God knows what's best. He's not a vending machine that just sort of doles out what you ask for. He's a good God and he gives you what is best. He gives you what is for his glory, actually. And you say, but I don't understand how this situation that I'm in could be best. Well, I don't either. I don't understand sometimes the things that I sit down with people and talk about, pastoral issues and things that are going on in people's lives. And I don't understand why that person is in that situation. As I've said before, if I had a magic wand and I could wave it, I would be waving it furiously. But I cannot do that. I do not understand. But we do need to be able to say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, I don't understand all things, but I do know that someday I will understand why those situations occur. Because the Bible says in 1 John 5:14-15, that when we pray according to God's will, that's when answers will come. And we can be confident that he will listen to us whenever we ask him for anything in line with his will. Very important. And if we know he is listening, when we make our request, we can be sure that he will give us what we ask for. You pray a prayer and God says, that's exactly in line with what I want to do. When you form a partnership with God, God grants our request. So the attitude must become, Lord, thy will be done. This is what I would like, Lord, but thy will be done. Like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, Lord, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, but nevertheless, thy will be done. This is what I want, this is what I desire, but thy will be done. Because God, you know what's best. Let me apply a little bit more what we've been thinking about this morning in practical ways. Let me give you three questions to reflect on as we bring this to a close. First, your plans. Do you include God in all your plans? I wonder which word best describes your attitude. Presumption or cooperation? Do you make your plans about what you're going to do without consulting God? Do you get up in the morning and think, this is what I will do today? You know, many Christians are practical atheists. They live as if God were not in control. And that's why, by the way, there's probably a lot of frustration in your life. But when you check in with God and ask, what is your will for my life? You understand and you ask for wisdom, then life is so much more smoother and satisfying and fulfilling instead of frustrating. You pray about your problems and plans, some of you, there are some people who say this, and I've heard it said, they may even said it to you, you may even say it. Someone says, you know, one day I'm going to become a Christian. In fact, I'm just waiting for the right time. Someday I'm going to commit my life to Christ. I've got a husband, a wife, a friend, a parent, a child who is a Christian. One of these days, I'm going to make my peace with God and ask forgiveness and make sure that I'm going to go to heaven. Know that I'm going to go to heaven when I die. I'm going to settle this. I'm really going to commit myself to this. I'm planning to do this, but I don't want to do it yet. Maybe I'll do it when I'm really, really old and I've only got a few more weeks left to live. Do you know what that is? That is absolute arrogant presumption. That is absolutely presumptuous. None of us have any guarantee of tomorrow. The longer I'm in pastoral ministry, the longer that I look at life, you suddenly see someone who's dead. They're alive today and they're dead tomorrow. The Bible says you don't boast about tomorrow because you don't even know what tomorrow is going to bring. You do not presume upon the future. You cannot. Now is the day of salvation, says the Bible. Today is the accepted time. Do it now while you know that you are still here and alive. Problems. Number two, do you look for God's purpose in your problems? Do you throw a pity party? Instead of asking why me, ask God, what do you want me to learn in this, through this, from this? And maybe you won't actually see the purpose at that point. That might come later on. Maybe God just wants you to trust him more, to trust him without question, to trust his goodness and graciousness and that he is in control. If you lost everything like Job, how would you respond? Would you have the maturity of faith to say the Lord gave, the Lord took away? Blessed be the name of the Lord. If he wants to restore it, he can do so. And if he doesn't, no worries. And thirdly, prayer. Do you take advantage of the privilege of prayer? See, it's there and we don't use it. Instead of complaining about that, the boss or your job, or why don't you try praying about your job? Instead of worrying about your finances, why don't you start praying about your finances? You'll have a lot less to worry about. Instead of giving up on your marriage, why don't you pray about your marriage? The things that are beyond your control are not beyond God's control. There is no attribute that is more comforting to the Christian than the attribute of God's sovereignty. He is in control. And some of you are thinking the situation that you're in is a big old mess. It's totally falling apart. Things feel hopeless. How big do you think God is? He's big enough to handle your mess. God knows how to turn bad into good, how to bring purpose out of problems. Don't waste your problems. Give them to God. So when you're worried sick, you say God is in control. When you feel defeated and discouraged, fallen flat on your face, and you feel like a total failure, you say God is in control. When you are unwell, when you have health issues, you say God is in control. When you're standing at a funeral wondering why at this time, you say God is in control. He's a good God. He's a great God. And when you read the headlines and you read about international chaos, you say, ah, yeah, but God is in control. When you face a problem you cannot handle on your own and it's out of your control, God is still in control. And because God is sovereign, he has a right to call the shots in your life. You wouldn't even be alive if it wasn't for God. He has a right to call those shots, and if you'll not let him do so, then you are in rebellion. You are living your life in rebellion, and that's why life is frustrating. That's why life is not working well for you at the moment. The most intelligent, rational decision you ever have to say, you ever have to make, is to say, God, you are sovereign. I want to cooperate with that, and I recognize that you have a right to call the shots in my life, and I'm going to cooperate with you. And you will find so much more fulfillment, meaning, purpose, satisfaction in your life. You'll find your niche and all of a sudden you'll think, wow, this is why I was created. This is why I'm here on earth. Because you're cooperating with the plan of God instead of fighting against it. God is in control whether you want to admit it or not, whether you think that is fair or not, whether you like it or not, he made you. He's decided when and where you were going to be born. He knows how long you are going to live. You can do nothing about that. And yet he loves you, and he is a good God. He doesn't take sovereignty and beat you over the head with it. He says, this is the way of fulfillment. It is the way for joy and purpose and meaning in life, cooperation with my plan. And I invite you to do that today. prayer, you might want to echo these statements in your heart. First of all, you might want to pray, God, I admit I made a lot of plans and I've never consulted you. I know that's probably why I've had a lot of problems in my life. I was presuming rather than cooperating. I want to start planning my life, counting on you to direct me. I realize the problems in my life have a purpose. And it doesn't matter whether you cause the problem yourself or the devil caused the problem or whether someone else has caused the problem and you're a victim. God will use them all in your life. There's nothing you cannot learn from it if you're responding the right way. Say, God, help me to look past the pain and see your purpose and what you want to teach me. Help me to trust you more. Some of us need to say, Lord, I want to become a praying person. You've given us this resource of prayer, and prayer can do what God can do, and yet I hardly even use it. I want to commit myself to becoming a person of prayer daily and regularly. And the things that are out of my control, I want to turn them over to you because they're not beyond your control. And I'm grateful for that. And when my plans change, I want to be flexible because I know that you're in charge. Father, we thank you that you are in charge. That is a wonderful comfort to us. And we look at the world and it's troubling to see chaos, and yet there is a grand design above it all. Even the problems that come into our lives are there by your permission. Help us to learn that our plans have a limit, our problems have a purpose, and our prayers have an impact.